Our scripture reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 22. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet. And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. And on entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. And they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night and went to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." When Herod saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. "A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing in loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more." When Herod died, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus, I need to see it in the Greek. Okay, this dude was ruling over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And after being warned in a dream, he went away to the district of Galilee. May God's blessing be upon this, his holy word.
Thank you. Thank you for preserving my voice, dear wife. I love you. Last month, during the second week of Advent, I said something to the effect of Christmas wouldn't be nearly as fun as it is today were it not for the pagans. And before I launch into this week's scripture lesson, I feel like I need to revisit that phrase. And we need to talk about what a lot of people don't understand about pagan. We had a little conversation about this last week in our fellowship time. But it's no secret that a lot of our Christmas traditions are borrowed from pagans. Yule logs, Advent wreaths, Christmas trees decking the halls with boughs of holly and green. It's Christmas stockings. Did you know that? Christmas stockings. Exchanging gifts. Christmas caroling. just the visual image of Santa Claus looking a little like Odin, you know. A lot of just about anything that is involved in the song, the 12 Days of Christmas, all of those are things that we borrowed from Northern European pagan traditions. And so over the years, these traditions have become a part of our Christmas celebration and worldwide. I mean, go to Australia and they've got Santa Claus in surfing in a bodysuit, you know, or in Japan, there's Christmas trees. So this is something that has become worldwide. But paganism isn't limited to the Germanic and Scandinavian pagans that we are most familiar with. See, the word pagan comes from the Latin word paganus, which means rustic or rural, which might be at best called folksy, or at worst, hillbilly or backwoods. It was actually kind of a derogatory term that was used by Christians in the 4th century to describe people who were not of the Christian faith or the Jewish faith. It wasn't until recently, and I'm talking recently, that some people started self-identifying as pagan. It's like they said, you know what, we're sick of y'all calling us pagans as if we're some kind of an insult. Fine, you want to call me a pagan because I'm not a Christian or a Jewish person? Great, pagan and proud. I will become a capital P pagan. But here's the thing, pagans and Methodists, work with me, I'm getting there. Methodists, Quakers, Baptists, Mormons did the same thing. They're like, you want to call us these things as if they're an insult? Fine, we're going to be that. And come to think of it, when you the term Christian was an insulting label that the Romans used to identify Christ's followers. And guess what? We liked it, and it stuck. So, let's talk about pagans, because Epiphany Sunday and Epiphany is all about the pagans. Really? Yes, really. The Magi, who came to Jerusalem inquiring about the Christ child, were pagans. Okay, so does that mean we need to exchange our little nativity set here and find one that has wise men that are adorned in animal skins, sporting Nordic facial tribal tattoos, and bringing gifts of mistletoe, ale, and mead to the Christ child? No. Again, pagans are simply those who practice a religious tradition other than Christianity or Judaism. Some say that the Magi were wise men, meaning philosophers or scholars. Some say they were alchemists or astrologers. Our opening song this morning was We Three Kings, because some mistakenly believe that they were royalty. And I'm going to tackle that one next week for Epiphany Sunday Part 2, so work with me. Most scholars agree that they were probably Zoroastrians, which is an obscure, ancient, pre-Christian, pre-Judaism religion that was monotheistic. And yes, that was weird, because that was one of the things about Judaism that was strange in that culture, is that they believed in one God. The Zoroastrians were the same thing. They worshipped the god Ahura Mazda. So again, that was strange for that time and place in history. They, the Zoroastrians, also believed in free will, judgment after death, angels, a messianic figure to deliver the world from evil. They shared similar beliefs, but again, they were pagans. They were other. They were that obscure little religion from over there in the land of the Persians. But they were first and foremost seekers. And that's what's important to us this morning, that they were seekers, because they sought wisdom. They sought the divine. They sought fortunes to tell the future. and their seeking led them to Jesus, the child king of a culture and a religion that was not theirs. Their seeking is also what protected them against Herod and his deception and his harm. So seeking is what Epiphany is all about in the church. Epiphany isn't until Friday, which is how many days after Christmas? Yep, 12 days, right. But we'll be celebrating it this Sunday and a little next Sunday, since technically the season of Epiphany lasts until February 22nd when we start Lenten season. But believe me, we'll take this down. The pine needles are starting to... So let's talk about the word epiphany. How do we usually define epiphany? If you had an epiphany, what is it? A light bulb? Yeah. That was good. Whoever did the sound effect, that was awesome. A revelation. Yeah. Those are words that we use to define epiphany. It's interesting because we use this term when we're explaining an illuminating discovery. The word is the same both in Latin and Greek, epiphania. Epiphania is most commonly translated as manifest or to manifest. So if you want to break the word down to its mechanics, epi is a preposition which means upon, and phania means shine. And so for these pagans from the East, the revelation of the Christ child was manifested through the star that appeared to them when they were still in their homeland, and that star shined upon the Christ child. And that's why it's called Epiphany. But that word isn't in the text. That word's not in any Latin or Greek or anything like that. That is what the church has assigned. That's the title we have assigned to this celebration. And the way the church traditionally interprets this story is God can use people from different religious traditions to affirm that God is a God of all peoples, for all peoples, for all tribes and nations. But you all know that already, because I've been saying that for 15 years now, and I know you've got it. What I want to do this morning is zero in on this notion of seeking and what it means for us. So let's see if we can discover what the Magi can teach us about being a seeker who is persistently seeking that which is sacred. Let's ask, in our seeking, what do we hope that God will reveal? So in their seeking, the Magi found that the Christ child was the incarnation of God on earth, and they gave gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. But they also received a gift too. They discovered that this divine incarnation was available to everyone and that it has the power to change the world. But as is often the case, we human beings don't know what to do with a gift that is freely given and available to everybody. We're suspicious, and rightly so. At what point in life did you discover that nothing was free? Was it when you received that little key in the mail from the car dealership in town? And, you know, you can take that key down to the car dealership and maybe, just maybe, it'll open that shiny little car down there and you get a free car? Yeah. Okay, maybe that's not a good example. That's not a good example because that's kind of more like gambling. You're taking a chance of the possibility of getting something for free. Plus, what they don't tell you is even if that key does open the door to the car, you've got to pay tax, title, tags, maintenance. Plus, you're going to have a salesperson who's going to be relentlessly pursuing you to upgrade and say, you really don't want this car. You want this shiny pickup truck over here. Not that I have any experience with that. All right, so maybe this is a better example. How about the timeshare people who say everyone who comes in to hear about what we have to offer gets a free dinner or free movie tickets? Well, there's no gambling there. It's not a lottery. It's not a raffle. Everyone gets a dinner. But is it really free? See, the price you pay is a high-pressure sales pitch and a lifetime of junk mail, both in your physical mailbox and in your email mailbox. Plus, they will sell your contact information to other businesses who will bombard you with junk mail long past the time that you die. Serious. Plus, they'll sell you, you also have to factor in how much time, at least your time, is worth. And then you have to ask yourself, was it really such a good deal in the end? You know, maybe the meal was good. Maybe the movie was good. But was it really free? See, I think this is why we have a hard time with the idea of God's grace being freely given. Because we, and when I say we, I mean the church, wants to make the gospel into a tit-for-tat, I guess we'd call it an achievement contest, where the one with the most willpower or spiritual brownie points wins. Okay? Richard Rohr, in his book Breathing Underwater, writes, "Grace is always a humiliation for the ego." See, he believes that the church has failed to deliver the good news about God's grace, and that this has robbed people of a vital spiritual experience. See, we've often reduced the gospel down to some fast food religion that is devoid of any deep transformation of self. We see this a lot in formerly Christian churches in Europe, or even countries or nations that were considered Christian in Europe, because without transformation of the self, the church ends up being transformed by the dominant culture instead of being the agent of change in that culture. Think about how many formerly Christian countries and nations have become consumer-oriented, proud, warlike, racist, class-conscious, and addictive. Yikes, Jesse, what do you mean formerly Christian countries? That sounds kind of like us. Well, that is certainly something to think about, isn't it? Rohr has something else to say here. He writes that when religion does not move its people to a mystical level of consciousness, it becomes more of a problem than a solution. At this level, it is largely incapable of its supreme task of healing, reconciling, forgiving, and peacemaking. See, when religion does not give people an inner life or any real prayer life, it is missing its primary vocation. Okay, well, sounds like we've got some work to do. Sounds like we need to do some seeking. Sounds like we need an epiphany, right? We are the Christian Church, disciples of Christ. Several years ago, under the leadership of our former general minister and president, Sharon Watkins, we identified three characteristics of what it means to be a disciple: true community, a passion for justice, and deep Christian spirituality were the three identifiers. Sharon encourage disciple congregations to seek and discover these three things. And as a movement, we're involved in all sorts of justice work. Oh my word, with so much. We're pretty good about talking about community too. We're great with outreach mission. Thank you for the report this morning, Georgia. We're doing well there. Where we have some work to do is in the realm of this deep Christian spirituality. and not the kind of surface-level spirituality that develops into some sort of a contest to see who is the most spiritual. Because spirituality, deep Christian spirituality to be specific, is a way of life that relates who we are to who God is as revealed to us in Jesus Christ and as experienced through the Holy Spirit. This is where we learn to encourage one another in the spiritual disciplines and practices. We're talking things like prayer and Bible study and worship and stewardship, service to others, hospitality to strangers, just to name a few. See, that sounds like a good way to prepare for Lenten season, doesn't it? Yes, it does. But let's take a look at an Old Testament perspective on Epiphany next week. And then we can take these beautiful pagan-inspired decorations down and do some inner work.